Welcome to the Art of Likeability, where you learn the secrets to becoming more likable in all areas of your life. Increasing your likeability improves your relationships, and improved relationships increases your success in all areas of your life. Let's jump in with your host, Arel Moody.
What's going on, Art of Likeability family? Arel Moody here, host of your show called The Art of Likeability. I'm excited. We have another long form interview today, and this one's going to be really special. We're going to be interviewing a gentleman who has got a really cool perspective on life and all his personal journey, which I think you'll really get a kick out of. And I think that if you apply some of these ideas, you're going to build some better relationships. You might build some more success. You might get some more happiness. And if you don't want any of those things, hit the stop button. Go watch something else, because that's what we're getting into right now. So with that said, I am excited to introduce, this is exciting for me. This is the first gentleman we've got from our friend across the pond. He's in the UK. You're going to hear a wonderful accent. He is not only someone who is in amazing shape, he's a natural bodybuilder for the MPA. He also has degrees in sports nutrition, biomechanics, and engineering. And he has done amazing stuff. And get this, he's done this at the age of over 40. So it's never too young, it's never too old to go after your dreams, whether it's professional bodybuilding, whether it's becoming a successful professional. He's just a really great person at developing not only himself, like his body with the bodybuilding, but developing who he is as a person and how you become a role model for other people. He's a family man. He's got two sons and a beautiful wife, from what I understand. And it's amazing to have this guy on the show. So everybody help me welcome Steve Park. What's going on, player? How you feeling?
I'm very good, Arel. How are you? Thank you for such a glowing introduction. I'm going to have to have you as my hype man, I think.
Now that's
with you.
That sounds good, man. You know what? And I know that, for all of our listeners that are over in the UK, you probably listen to me and you're like, whoa, this dude Arel sounds really weird because I got my New York accent. Hopefully you like my accent, but I think 90% of people are just going to be excited just listening to Steve talk. He could say whatever he wants and it's just going to be likable because it's just a great tone and timber. Yeah. So tell us a little bit more about yourself. You got an interesting story. You actually got some, obviously you got some incredible degrees. You've got, you've achieved some personal goals that have been incredible. But, if I were to ask you, Steve, what's your story, man? Tell me who you are. Why should I care about what you have to say? Why would I even want to listen to you? What would you say to that?
Oh, well, thank you. Well, I think my story probably doesn't differ too much from anyone else's. I mean, when I was a younger boy, probably sort of age 9, 10, I was quite a large young man. So I was relatively shy because I felt insecure. Obviously sort of normally stood back. So I wasn't always in the center of the crowd or the center of the action. I was the one standing back. And in hindsight, that was probably quite an advantage because what that gave me was a perspective to look at things from the outside in. So I wasn't always the one talking to people or interacting, but I was the one on the outside seeing how if somebody interacted with someone else, the way they phrased the word, the way they said something, how that other person would react to it. It could be favorable, it could be non-favorable, but and that taught me that once I hopefully would come out of my shell, I was always going to be very knowledgeable and hopefully very careful in the way that I put things to get the best out of people. So that was probably my first introduction, and also having such a great family, they always taught me the old school values of good manners, being polite, saying thank you, being courteous to my elders. And even as a child, my mum used to take me shopping with her. We didn't have a car at the time and my dad was at work. So I used to always go shopping with my mum. And I always noticed that whenever she was at the tills with the ladies serving us at the tills, she'd always chat to them. Most people would just go through and they'd nod and they'd grunt at the staff. My mum would always have a chat and say, how are you doing? You're okay? Isn't it busy here? All that kind of thing. And she just got such a warm response that even to this day, I tend to do that and our boys tend to do that. And it's just one of those things I sort of built up over the years, those sort of characters. You always tend to do what you see rather than what you're told to do.
Mm, right.
So that was one of the things. And over the years, I've sort of got into fitness and training, nutrition, and also how the brain works, sort of looking at the chemistry of the brain and so on. So that helped me to develop my body physically, but also hopefully developed my character and personality to where I'm at a stage where I feel very comfortable in my skin, being over 40, but also getting to feel very, very comfortable with my character and how people see me and how I see myself.
You know, you brought up two things that I really want to delve into because I think they were important, and it could have gotten missed if you were casually listening to that amazing timbre in Steve's voice. But what you really did is you took something that others might perceive as a weakness or a character flaw, and you actually turned it into a really powerful strength. So where some people may say, oh, well, I'm not the life of the party, I'm not the person who is the most charismatic, or I wish I was like that. Instead, I'm the person who doesn't know what to say. I'm the shy person. Like, that's a very self-defeating, negative way for us to speak to ourselves. But what I heard from your story is you said, no, I'm actually getting to observe how people are interacting. I'm getting to actually see what this person says, how this person responds. Maybe I'm getting to catch things that the person inside of the conversation won't see or won't catch. Maybe it's a way they raise their eyebrow or a way that they, you know, look, because you can actually observe a situation. So I just want to say that that's a very powerful concept of taking whatever your current playing field is. If you're the most charismatic person, making that your strength. If you're more of a listener, making that your strength, and using that to actually build yourself up so that people will like you more, because your focus is not on what you're lacking, but how you turn that weakness into a strength. Is that something that was a conscious decision? How did you get to that? Because it's a very powerful concept, and I just want to know where that came from for you.
Yeah, I mean, especially being at such a young age, I was always a big fan of drama. I mean, the sort of juxtaposition with my situation. I was young, I was very shy, but then you put me in a drama theater for the 400 people, I could act my behind off. So, you know, you take me out of my own character and say, okay, Steve, today you're playing Hamlet, or today you're playing B.A. Baracus from the A-Team. I'd just be able to take it on a dime. Mm. But being able to be myself, it just allowed me, because I knew I couldn't, or at that time I thought I couldn't be that confident, but what I could do is just take it easy and see how people react with one another. And even to today, I tend to be like that. I'm not always the one first one in. I'll stand back and I'll get a feel for somebody, or I'll get a feel for the situation. And it's been really quite advantageous, because it stopped me, you know, sometimes when people go in full steam ahead and they sort of barge into a situation and they just say or do the wrong thing. I've luckily, touch wood, and hopefully manage to avoid that, because I'll stand back and get a feel for a situation. Is it quite an active vibe? Is it a calmer vibe? Should I approach this situation more slowly and cautiously? Can I go in with my full personality? And then I'll sort of gauge it from there. So it was something that I think I just tried to use to my advantage. I knew I wasn't going to be the most charming person on a situation, but I could be the most thoughtful. I could be the most conscious person on how I'm talking to somebody, how to get the best reaction out of somebody, how to work with someone. So I think that was always my sort of a way of thinking, if any.
Yeah, and it's so important, because I tend to find one of the biggest challenges when I'm observing people is that they think they have to sound like someone. They have to be like me or you, or they're saying, well, of course this other person is likable, or because they're funny, I'm not as funny as Jim Carrey is, so of course he's likable, he's making everybody, you know, laugh all over the place. But instead you say, what is it that I do, what is my natural inclination, and how do I use that to my strength? I may not be as funny as Jim Carrey is, but I can listen very well. I can observe very well. I can maybe act and, you know, go and do plays and play to my strength so I can be that character I want to be. So I think that's a very valuable, very, very, it's almost game changing, like life changing, when someone can say, hey, here's what my natural inclinations are. This is what my intuition says. This is who I am. And instead of breaking it and being someone that I'm not, that goes to the idea of being authentic to yourself. If you can be authentic to yourself and in the best way possible, you can really use that as one of the most valuable strengths that you have, instead of being someone you're not. So I think that's fantastic.
Thank you.
Yeah. Now tell me more about the biomechanics and the fitness and the bodybuilding. You know, how do you make a conscious choice because you're unhappy? Is this part of an overall goal to get like a woman? Like, what makes someone get so interested in how the body works and to actually get into, you know, competitive field of bodybuilding?
Yeah, well, I must admit, I've always been, although, you know, at a young age, very quiet, I've always been super inquisitive. So I'm the kind of person that if you say, okay, this is a V8 engine in a Chevy Camaro, Steve, and it has 350 brake horsepower. I'm like, okay, why does it have that? How does the V8 engine work? What parts go there? Why does it do that? So I'm always very inquisitive, especially to certain subjects. So I always like to know how things work. So when I did actually start training, I wanted to know how I could train the most effectively, be in the gym the least, because I always like my sleep. So if I could spend more time resting and sleeping, that's always going to be a preference. And also with my friends. So I just wanted to hopefully capitalize the most I could with the time I had, and also be able to give this kind of knowledge onto somebody in a practical way. So I sort of took it on myself to learn the crux and the complicated aspect of things. So hopefully I'd be able to relay that to somebody in a bit more of a layman's term so they could understand it in a more practical basis. And it was really just to make sure that I had all the bases covered. So a lot of these things tied together. Some people wouldn't necessarily think so, but they have such a connection with one another that if you can try to cover all the bases and get to know them, it could only not only make you a better essentially sports person or bodybuilder, but a better person overall, because these kind of practices can translate into other avenues of your life.
Right. So that, you know, the idea of the inquisitive nature is also very powerful. I think that one of the biggest separators between people who reach some type of standard, some type of goal of success, is just really being curious to say, well, how does this work? I mean, that's how this podcast, The Likeability, really came into reality. Was it was years and years of me having this desire to understand, why is someone likable? Why is someone charismatic? Why is someone a good leader? And really trying to break it down the same way you said, hey, it's a V8 engine. Why is it a V8 engine? Let me break it down. Why do you work out this way? How do I, do this and do that? So I think that is very important. So tell me about, now you mentioned something about how your mother would treat people and how you noticed that interacted. Tell me more about that. Is that something that you just did? Is that something that you've noticed some great results from? What's the idea behind the talk to the person at the shop counter? Is it the same way you would talk to the CEO? I'd really love to hear your insights to that.
Yeah, no, certainly. Thank you. Well, it was something, because my parents, you know, they always tried to raise me and my sister the right way. And I think it's pretty much the same with all children and adolescents. You can tell a child 100 times not to do this, don't do that, you're going to hurt yourself. That's not the right thing to do. But what you have to do is show them the right thing to do. And you have to do that every day, all the time, automatically. And then they'll pick that habit up. And that can be both good and bad. If you are doing something really bad and detrimental, they'll pick that habit up. But if you're doing something really good and positive, they'll pick that up as well. So in the case of my mother and my father, they would just treat everyone the same way. And there was, you know, they were smiling at people, saying hello to strangers in the street. I always thought when I was a child that my mum and dad knew everyone they spoke to. And they spoke to everybody. It turned out they didn't know everybody. They were just friendly to everyone. They just said hello to everybody that went by or smiled at them. So that sort of brought that kind of character out of me. So as I was growing up, one of the little challenges I set myself with was just to say hi to people in the street or give them a smile. And that was quite a hard challenge because, you know, being relatively shy is not an easy thing to do. But you find that at the very least, you'll get a smile back. And chances are you'll get a smile and a hello back. And that was something quite revolutionary because I thought this is just too much. I shouldn't have even thought to do this. But once you get into doing it, now it's a habit. I walk past somebody, give them a little wave or a smile or a little nod of acknowledgement. So it's not like I'm blanking them at all. And my mum and dad just to just always do that with anyone, a cashier, the street cleaner, the bin men, whoever they were. It was clear to see, even at a very young age, they didn't treat people based on their position or the job they did. They just treated them the same way. And you could, if you were to take away the visual aspect and hear how they would talk to a colleague or a friend or a cashier, or they would talk to their boss, you could hardly tell the difference because they still had that same level of respect and that same level of courteousness and kindness and caring right across the board.
Now, this is a powerful idea, and I want to make sure we do it correctly, because I believe there are nuances to everything, you know. So, for example, smiling and saying hello is important, but what if I... How do I not be a creeper when I do it? That's my question. Like, how do I, if I'm walking down the street and I'm just saying hello, when do you feel like you've crossed into I'm being a creeper, or I'm being I'm practicing this philosophy that's helped you so well? What's the distinction between appropriate and inappropriate use of this?
Yeah, well, I think it's in certain situations. I mean, if you're walking to a crowded shopping center saying hello to everybody and trying to smile at them, that's probably going to look a little bit strange. But if you're going for sort of a nice country walk, say in a country park, or, walking, I mean, we have a pet puppy at the moment. So what you find is dog owners always talk to each other. It's almost like an unwritten rule, really. So
right.
they always give each other a nod and say hello and, you know, how old's your dog? How old's your dog? What breed is it? So there's almost an unwritten rule that you're going to talk. So that's always a very familiar, comfortable situation to do something such as that in. But I think when people are walking recreationally, not, you know, when they're walking back and forth to work, that's always a good sign. And you can always tell, because if you're walking up to, say, like, I'm walking up to you, you always tend to sort of gaze the person coming. It may be a very quick glance, it may be, you know, a fleeting moment, but from that second you can kind of tell if that person has engaged with you. And, you know, sometimes you walk past someone and they've got a little bit of a wry smile on their face, and I think that's the time you can say, hi, how you doing? Because it's almost like they're inviting you to say something, or acknowledge them at the very least. And there's also those scenarios where people are looking straight down at the ground. They don't want to be disturbed. They don't want to talk to anybody. They just want to get to where they're going with the minimal interaction. And in that scenario, it's best to leave alone. And you will get that feeling of when it's right and when it's not right. But, you know, there's plenty of opportunities every day I come across that it's right more than not being right. But you will, over time, be able to pick up that subtle nuance. And I also really find that, and the nice thing is, the older generation really appreciate it. So, you know, the younger kids is kind of like, whatever. But, you know, if you can be, for once I'm seen as a relatively young person, but somebody sort of 80 or so, and say hi and give them a nice big broad smile, that really surprises them, especially nowadays. You don't tend to get that very often. So that can be a real nice surprise to them. They're like, oh, hi, hello, how you doing? Have a nice day, you know. And it just opens it up. It's a conversation that could have been missed totally.
Yeah, and that actually is very valuable. Two parts that I liked about it. Number one, you know, I believe in this strategy. I employ it myself. I believe that, you know, saying hello, engaging people, no matter who they are from whatever background, is a great practice. But if someone has their head down and they're listening to their, you know, iPod or something, jumping in front of them and be like, hey, what's going on? I just wanted to say hi. It's a very bad choice. So you should practice this, but you shouldn't go out of your way to disrupt someone so that you can practice this. That's an important specification. And then in addition to that, you said something that is very valuable, and I want to dive a little bit deeper into it. There is this interesting, and it's global. It's not UK based. It's not American based. It's not Australian based. There's a global shift that's occurring, and I've been noticing it's a shift of how young people find interacting with each other to be acceptable, and how older generations find interacting with people to be acceptable. I've noticed, I speak all over the country and in America, and I've spoken overseas in a few countries, and I've noticed that younger people, if you give them a handshake, they will not make eye contact with you, or they'll give you a soft handshake, or there's these unwritten laws of strong communication that seem to not be passing. Now, not everyone, of course. I'm not saying this is a blanket statement, but I'm noticing it more and more, that more and more young people aren't feeling comfortable making eye contact, feeling comfortable smiling, where someone from an older generation, that's what you do to say that you are a respectable person. Have you found that the way you interact with someone who is, say, under 40 versus over 40, have you noticed a difference in how this strategy of saying hello to everyone actually plays out?
Yeah, very, very true. It's like it's sort of a the way somebody's brought up and the friends and social interaction they have with you know, people of their own age and their peers. And it is very true. It's almost like, you know, it's almost a given. You meet somebody new, or, you know, say, oh, this is a well, I'm introducing you to so-and-so, and you'll give them a nice firm handshake and how you doing, how's everything going, you have a bit of a conversation. But on a younger basis, if you're sort of 10, 12, 13, and you're introducing somebody, it's a very much of a different dynamic. And so there's not that necessarily the sort of handshake and, you know, the asking of how things are going, how's your day going. It's more like, oh, where did you get your trainers from? Where did you get your watch? What iPhone have you got? Oh, what tune have you? You know, it's a whole different paradigm. The questions are still there, but they're just a different form of question. There's a different interest. So, yes, I think there's definitely a shift with that. And, it's sometimes it's nice to see them. I mean, it's super refreshing when you see a younger person still being able to be a young hip kid, but still being able to exhibit those older, more mature manners. And that will stand out like, you know, like a missile. You know, it just puts them head and shoulders above other children, because they can conduct themselves with people their own age, but then you put them in a situation where they're dealing with people their parents' age and their grandparents' age, and they can still hold their own. And that is cool. That's crazy cool to see. You don't see it very often, but it is very cool to see.
And that's the important thing. It's that hybrid approach. They, yes, you should be able to be up on what's happening right now and know how to send a text and know how to, you know, send a tweet and all of those other things, but also being able to, you know, what's called code switch. Code switching is the ability to interact in different environments without losing your authentic self. The easiest example of this is how you speak to your, you know, elderly grandmother at a Sunday dinner. A Sunday dinner is very different than you interact and talk with your best friends on a Saturday night at the party. So those different approaches is code switching. So a lot of times people say, well, I'm not going to like shake someone's hand, or I'm not going to say hello because that's not me. It's not really about losing your authentic self. It's about understanding it's a tool. It's all it is a tool. You know, knowing how to shake someone's hand, that's a tool. That's a way to interact with someone. Knowing how to tweet and Facebook and all that stuff, that's just a tool. So these tools help us get better results with our relationship building. So this is my question to you. It's a question that almost begs to be asked. Why do I even care about saying hello to all these people? Why is it important? Like, okay, it's something that I practice, it's something that you practice, but why should I care about interacting with everyone or saying hello or bringing this kind of smile? What's the point? What's the end goal of it all?
Yeah, well, I think one is, looking on the aspect of elevating you, it takes you a cut above the rest. 99% of the people that person may walk by or, you know, interact with to a degree, probably wouldn't have been as friendly or as kind or as warm as you would have been with a hello and a little nod and a smile. Most would have blanked up totally for that day, especially sometimes the older generation. So I think that's one very important aspect, is to treat people how you'd like to be treated. If you were to walk in that person's shoes and people were ignoring you all day and nobody paid you any attention unless they were getting paid to or they had to, you probably wouldn't feel very, very good about yourself. But if some stranger comes up and or walks by you and you acknowledge them, they acknowledge you, they give you a little nod, a little smile, sometimes that can be the highlight of your day, you know. Mm-hmm. And you're telling your friends, oh, I met her well and he gave me a little smile, you got a cheeky, lovely smile and you're so friendly, or, you know, this young man walked past me and gave me a smile. Sometimes that can be a highlight of somebody's day. And I think that's important, to be able to give that to somebody without asking for anything. And also it builds up your confidence. If you can do that to strangers, if you can do that very small bit of introduction to strangers, then getting up in front of people on a stage, getting up in front of people in a meeting, using those skills when you're at work and when you're employing it in your own business, makes it a lot easier, because that's way more difficult to do. When you're up on a stage, you have a captive audience. They know what you're talking about. They know what to expect. When you're in a meeting, again, they know what you're generally talking about. They know what to expect. When you're walking past somebody, that's, you know, you're having to think on your toes. You're having to gauge and judge the reaction of that other person. Should I say hello? Should I not? Is this an appropriate time? Should I leave it? You're having to really think on your toes. So I think it's very good for your thought process and judging the situation as well, I'd say.
You know, and I think that's such a great, I mean, you said something that just, man, it stands out to me so much, this idea of being a cut above the rest, right?
Yeah.
And it's practice. It's the practicing becoming you know, with this mindset of I'm going to do what most people won't so that I can have what most people don't. Most people won't do this. Let me practice this skill set so that when I do need to say hello to someone, or when it's like it's a very valuable moment for me to break my comfort zone, and you know, maybe it's Oprah or it's, you know, someone who is a role model of yours, you've practiced so many times reading people how to say hello, whether you should say hello, how to interact with them, that it's almost automatic. You know, it's almost just, this is just what it's like what you said. This is just what we do. It's what my mom did. It's what I do. It's what my kids do. This is what we do. And when you get to that place, you're at a level of automatic mastery. And that's where we want to get. And it doesn't happen overnight. That comes with constantly practicing and working. And, you know, and I know, you know, a lot about, you know, how the body works and how diet works and everything, this idea of consistent practice and making things easier. Are there any parallels that you can share with us how doing something repetitively makes it easier or better, or are there any analogies that you can draw from your knowledge of how the human body works to make this idea maybe more tangible?
Yeah. I mean, it's a very good point. Basically the way the system and the body works and the brain works very similarly to the practice of saying hello and introducing yourself to people or being in a situation where which it scares you, such as a big meeting and you might be chairing a meeting or performing a part in that meeting. The more often you do that, the better you'll get at it. The first time will be horrible. You'll be a bag of nerves. The next time you do it, you'll know what to expect. You'll be a little bit calmer. 10 times down the line and you'll be doing it almost in your sleep, because your brain will actually, once it's done that scenario, normally your brain will think, you know what, that wasn't too bad. It worked out okay. Next time, we'll be cool with it. And each time, even though when you go to sleep, even the next day, your brain's running through that scenario over and over again, and it's making new pathways and it's linking things up. So the next time you do it, you'll be a little bit sharper at it. You'll be a little bit cooler, a little bit cleaner at it, and you'll do better. And you'll be prepared for the knockback, which we all get occasionally, but you'll also be prepared for success. And that analogy goes all the way through from the practice of introducing yourself to people and the likability aspect, all the way through to training, nutrition. It's all a habit of practice. And the more often you can do the right practice or do the right thing, the more chance you have of getting success. Everyone messes up every now and again, but if you can get it 80 or 90% right, the other 20% or so is not a big deal. You know, it's not going to make or break it. You're sort of pushing and stacking the odds way more in your favor than if you didn't do it at all.
Right. You know, and that's the thing that is so fascinating. Just the idea of, you know, wanting to practice. Now many times we just, like, how do you get over that? You know, there's a hump that I know, and I know that you train people as a personal trainer, and you've got your parkour training that you've launched where you help people. But whether we want to practice saying hello to everyone or whether we want to start working out at the gym, there's always this hump. There's this hurdle of, I don't want to do it, or I know I should do it. Of course I should do it. You're right. Or okay, Arel, Steve, you guys made sense. I get it. I should totally do it. But I just can't. I can't do it. I can't get myself to actually do the smile or wave my hand or get up and go to the gym. How do we overcome that? How do we say, okay, I know I should be doing whatever it might be. In this particular conversation, we're talking about the, you know, interacting with everyone on a common level. But if we're so stuck in our minds that we can't actually do it, we'll never actually achieve the benefits. So how do we get over it? What could you recommend, a strategy, a specific thing someone can do to get over that initial hurdle of resistance?
Yeah, a very good point. And I've had that myself, because it is a big leap. I mean, I'll probably talk about it a little bit lightly in a sense, because it's been a long time. But I think for me, that the way I started to work this practice and try to utilize and bring this practice into fruition is I started to do it with my work colleagues. I mean, these are people that I would see every day, and it's not unusual for a work colleague to say, hi, how are you doing, and have a little bit of a chat at the water cooler. So then I would make a mental note in my head that I'm going to say hi to 5 people that I've not spoken to at work before. And then that's how I started it off. So I'd say hi to 5 people. And it's sometimes it's literally just a hi, how you doing? And then that's it. You know, you pass each other in the corridor, done. But you said hi. So take that one off your list. You've got four more to go to that day. And that's how I initially started it, because it was a very comfortable environment. It wasn't too far in for me. It wasn't going to be perceived as being creepy or odd. You're saying hi to a work colleague, nothing odd about that. And it also gave me the courage to think to myself, well, hey, they said hello back. We had a little conversation. Maybe it's not that hard. And then slowly but surely give yourself a target of speaking to one person on your lunchtime walk, or saying hello to one person on your lunchtime walk, and building up from there. Because the secret to it, I think, is to a large degree, and it does vary from person to person, is to take it in baby steps. If I said to somebody that I'd never done this practice before, I want you to say hello to 50 people today, and I don't want to hear from you until you've done it, it's not going to happen. But if you say to somebody, just say hi to somebody today that you've not said hi to before, and give them a nice smile, or even just smile at them, then that's your job done today, and you can get on with everything else. You can tick that off your list. It's those small little baby steps, it's those small little triumphs and wins that make it easier to progress. And then you look on a calendar and you started 2 months ago by saying hi to one person and interacting with one person, and now 2-3 months down the line, you're doing it with 20, and you're not even knowing who you've done it to. You know, it's almost automatic, as we said before. It's just something you do now.
Right. So it's really about starting where you are. You know, it's, hey, what's a low pressure, easy environment? Like you said, I'll start with my work colleagues. Who's someone that I don't know? Let me say hello to them. Let me engage them. So that's a very good idea. And I think that whatever it is, and I'm a big advocate of, so the first book I wrote, I have something in there where I say, if you want to get into shape, just don't worry about the gym. Don't just do 10 push-ups. Like if you've never worked out before, just wake up in the morning, do 10 push-ups or as many as you can do, and then you're done. Don't even think about it. You're done. Like cross it off your list, and then eventually 10 is going to feel silly to you. It's ridiculous. I can't do 10. I'll do 15. I feel a little burned when I do. 15 is ridiculous. And then eventually you say, well, let me actually start, you know, going. So, you know, you start where you are, and you just say, what's a low pressure barrier to entry way for me to apply any new philosophy? So in this case, we do want you to start practicing saying hello to more people, being a person that smiles and says hello and engages people in conversations, whether you're doing it on Twitter or you're doing it in this case in real life. But you start where you can. So maybe it's your neighborhood, maybe it's your friends, maybe it's a friend of a friend or something. So it's very valuable to realize that practice over time is what's going to lead to your best results. One of the things that I think people forget is how long something takes. Yes, there's ways to speed it up, and the Art of Likeability, this podcast, will help you cut your learning curve. But at the end of the day, there's no substitute for good old-fashioned hard work. There's no substitute for dedication. And I think that over time, people say, well, I don't have 5 years to build my reputation. I need to build it now. But you know what? You're going to be 5 years older in 5 years if you don't die, God willingly. So you might as well be in a better place 5 years from now. If you could throw in a parallel, and I want to tie in a little to your fitness background. You know, you obviously are someone at peak physical shape. You are, you know, competing in bodybuilding to do so. That takes time. How, and I want to get people to understand what work ethic is like. How long would you say it takes or took you to go from, hey, I kind of like fitness, to, yeah, you know, this is, I'm in a place where I can actually go and compete? How long does that process take?
That was a good 5 or 6 years, I would say, quite easily, to go from that stage of being the new boy and a novice in the gym and just being awestruck in the gym and almost scared and shaky with sweaty palms, to being able to walk into a gym, know what exercises I wanted to do, and also even just go in there and think, you know what, I'm doing it, literally go ad hoc on it and just go with the feel, and then know how, and it also expands into not only knowing how to train yourself and utilize those skills to develop yourself, but also how to train others. And then that develops in how to train certain athletes and certain types of people, and also what approach would work best with one person may not work with another. So in that sense, you're always learning. I mean, even now, I'm sort of classed as a master's class, so AKA just very old in the bodybuilding category. But I'm still learning now, and even when I'm sort of teaching clients and speaking to people, that my approach for each person is a little bit different, because, you know, what might get somebody excited and wanting to work out with me on one day may not work on another day or may not work with another person. So it's still very much a learning curve, but definitely from when I started first showing an interest in training, and my mom and dad bought me my first, you know, bodybuilding magazine and my first set of plastic weights, to being up on stage, it was a good 7 years till I felt I had a good foundation and I could hold my own and I was comfortable up on stage among all these other competitors, and I felt, you know, I deserved to be there. Yeah, definitely.
So now, how does that apply to that level of fitness dedication, that level of, okay, it's taking me 5 to 6 years of hard work? What parallels have you noticed in the way you interact with people? What parallels have you noticed with how you've started learning to develop as a competitor in bodybuilding with developing your skills with interacting with people?
Very, very good. I mean, the parallels are really very similar in a sense that as you train, I mean, as, for instance, as you're developing your body, that's a very visceral thing to see. I mean, it's something you can see day by day. Other people can see it in you. They can judge that from a distance. But also when somebody's getting to know you, that's something that takes a lot longer, because they need to get to know your character, your little quirks, how you react with them, and also they need to trust you. So you need to be a person of your word. So if you say you're going to help somebody move on a Saturday and it takes out your whole Saturday, you don't ring up on a Friday evening and say, you know, I'm watching the game, sorry, I'm gonna have to let you down. You stick to that promise. Even if it's not the most fun thing to do, you stick to that promise because you made that promise, and that's character building. So when you say you're going to do something, you do it. Whether that's show up in the gym, or whether that's help somebody move, or whether that's, you know, help somebody paint their house. And normally the thing that really build your character are the things that aren't fun. You know, if I invited three of my friends on a Hawaiian holiday and said, okay, you guys are gonna be there at the airport for 6 o'clock, probably most of my friends will be there, you know, 5 to 6. Really, it's not a big deal. But, you know, if I said, you know, I need to move house and you need to be at my house for 6 o'clock so we can do the move, the ones that are going to show up are the ones that are going to have the character and, you know, going to have that fortitude and that self-worth to stick to their word. And that's always been something, again, taught by my parents, is to stick to your word. If you say you're going to do something, you do it. Whether it's fun for you or not, you promise somebody, you do that thing. So that's sort of one really big parallel, is just to make sure that you stick to what you do. And also, I guess you're a role model, because everything you do, people see or they hear. Even when you're on the phone, even when you send an email, the way you phrase a word, the way you interact with people over the phone, or the way your email comes across and the words you use within that email, starts to build up a character or a picture of your character with somebody that may have never met you or spoken to you before. You know, they're thinking, oh, he's a really nice guy, or I don't know about him, I'm not sure if I trust him. So already you're building up a character. So I think the important thing is to be very conscious of what you're doing, always try to put your best foot forward, and then try to represent yourself the best way you could. I always look at it as if trying to make my mom and dad proud, as odd as it seems. You know, if they saw me interacting with somebody from an older generation or a younger generation, would they be proud of the way I'm acting? Would they be proud of the way I'm treating somebody as their son?
Right. Powerful stuff, man. Man, I love it, man. This is just, Steve, man, it's been really great connecting with you and just hearing you. You just set your the way you set the goals, the way you practice it, the way you view it. I think there's so much to be gained from it, and there's so many strategies that we can do. And I think having, you know, even parameters that, like you said, like, am I making this person proud? Like, am I living my life in a way that this person will be happy with? Goes, it really does help you make easier decisions, and also helps you push yourself. You know, we talked about how to, you know, take where you currently are and change it, you know, change your perspective on it. So if you're talkative, use that to your advantage. If you're quiet, use that to your advantage, and change the way you view it and interacting with people and how we can say hello to people, because it builds that practice. It's like, you know, it's building the muscle, you know, each rep, each time you lift the weight, the muscle gets a little better, a little stronger. And each time you say hello to someone, each time you connect with someone, it becomes a little easier and it becomes stronger for you to connect with people. And you just keep these parameters and you find ways to interact with people, and there's just amazing results that will happen when we put this into practice. And so now I know we got a lot of listeners in the UK, and hopefully people are really interested in, you know, hearing more about what you have to say. And I know that you know just launched your Facebook page, Parkour Personal Training. It's Parke CORE, personal training. So you can just kind of just connect with him, what he's doing. If there's other ways that people want to connect with you, what's the best way for people to reach you, Steve?
I'm very lucky because I have my beautiful wife, Mandy, and she does a lot of the kind of things that I'm terrible at. I can do the training and the dieting side of things, but she does a lot of the Facebook things that just blow my mind, really. So I'm very fortunate to have her on my team, and our two boys, Kieran and Tyler, are a great help. So if anybody would like to get hold of me, we have they can get hold of us at parkour, which is parkecore at gmail.com, and anything you send over there, we can get back to you on. We do consultations, and that will also have our phone number details on, so if you want to give me a call and run through some of your needs or any way that we can help you develop yourselves, obviously physically, but also relaxation and well-being, we'll be more than honored to see if we can help in some way.
But what if I live in Australia? What if I live in America? Can you help me?
I can help you. I can help you, because that's the beauty of Skype. We can always do a Skype conference. We can run over your diet schedule, make sure you keep your training on point. I can be that little either angel or devil on your shoulder, making sure you've done what you said you're going to do. Be there either way. So it's not a problem.
Very cool. So if you want to develop not only your mind, but if you want to develop your body, if you want to develop your social skills, obviously Steve is someone who's really kind of melding all of these together, which I think is a beautiful way to do it. So Steve, thank you so much for taking your time to connect with us here at the Art of Likeability. Thank you for helping us build our success skills, help us building our relationships, helping us get better at practicing and going to do the things that we know we need to succeed. And I'm curious, people, let me know what you think. I'm talking to you right now. If you enjoyed the show, if you thought this was great, let us know. The greatest way for me to know if we should do more interviews like this, if we should bring Steve back, if we should do other stuff, is by your comments. So please leave comments on iTunes. If you want to connect with me directly, shoot me an email at info@artoflikeability.com. Hit me up on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, Snapchat. If you own it, I'm on it. I'm the only Arel Moody there is. A-R-E-L. M as in Mary, O-O, D as in David, I-E. So if you just Google my name or you put it into any of those social media sites, you'll find me. I literally have been getting emails and LinkedIn messages from people all over the world. And it's been just an honor to make new friends from, just got a message from Thailand. So shout out to my folks out there in Thailand. It's an incredible honor. So let me know what you think. Make sure to subscribe to the show if you haven't subscribed yet. We put out long form interviews like this. We also got some really cool short form content as well. So we're here to make your life more likable and more awesome. So first, before we go, Steve, I gotta give you a high five. You can't see me, but I'm sending you over the pond a big high five. Here it is. Bam! Did you feel it? Did you get it? Did you get it?
Right back. You're there. Well, right back. Boom, baby. Right back. And I just wanted to say thank you for having me on. It's been a pleasure. The show, big fan, and just keep up the good work, and always be following you. So thank you very much. You do a great job.
I appreciate that, man. It's an honor to have you on here. And Steve, and just to give you guys some insights, I'm going to just give you the real deal here. Steve is a listener of the show. He reached out to me, said, Arel, let's chat. We started chatting and we went back and forth, and we found ourselves here today. So I love interacting with people, and I love people who have great stuff to share. So please connect with me. And I'm now sending you, listening to me, a big old high five. You are awesome.
Thanks for listening to The Art of Likeability. Please remember to subscribe to the podcast for more awesome info on how you can improve your likeability and improve your life. Until next time, remember,